The 2012-2013 Linus Pauling Memorial Lectures. My name is Terry Bristol, and I'm the president of the Institute for Science, Engineering, and Public Policy, and it's the institute that organizes these. The entertainment for this evening is to be a shocking revaluation of everything you've ever been or done. And seriously, what I'm going to lay on you tonight is a very, very broad overview of a change in the way we look at the universe and ourselves. It's not really new. I could trace it all the way back. Various times it's come up, and it's probably here now. In fact, the sort of thing that I do, we always say we're simply reporting what other people have done, pulling together ideas. That's what I'm going to try and do. And I gave this talk in Beijing, actually, with a group called the Forum on Philosophy, Engineering, and Technology in November. Very well received, and there was a guy there who gave almost identical talk, or at least thematically, which was very encouraging. The Chinese sort of get this, I think, a little more than we do in the United States, because they had the sort of technological push from the Marxist sort of program initially. So anyway, but when I presented there, and then I presented a couple of times to smaller groups, there has been one sort of misunderstanding, I'll call it, and it's mostly semantic, but it's also substantive. It has the use of the word science. So as we get into this, you'll see in your program, it talks about the scientific worldview, and so instead of calling it that, I'm going to call it the mechanical worldview, which is, you know, really what started with Galileo and went up through Newton and so forth. Everything is a cause, has a cause and effect, and repeatable. Things are, when you have knowledge, that knowledge is something you can transfer over space and time and so forth. Anyway, we'll get into that, but I'll let you know that that's coming. Okay, real quick, who am I, if you don't know? So I taught at Linfield for about 7 years, and Portland State roughly the same amount. Philosophy of science, logic, all that sort of stuff. My background is really philosophy of science, which is now morphed into philosophy of engineering, as you might notice. I did my undergraduate at Berkeley, and then I did like 5 years in London in graduate school. And these are my kind of mentors and guys I hung out with. Sir Carl is the padre padron of everybody in philosophy of science. You say, you know, who said something in philosophy of science? Karl Popper is one of the three or four people that people see. And Thomas Kuhn, who wrote this famous book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. Also then Paul Feyerabend, who was my honors thesis advisor in Berkeley, and then he's something called an anarchist, scientific anarchist, and Imre Lakatos, who was a scientific fascist, and they had a great relationship. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is I want to move you from to the engineering worldview, as I'm calling it, and you'll see what I mean. I'm going to clarify what I mean by engineering, because you may know some engineers and think they're a bunch of nerds, and what am I talking about? My idea of engineering is creative problem solving in a particular way that you'll see. So, but it's a paradigm shift, and a paradigm shift is not easy. And one of the reasons this hasn't happened before is because it is a paradigm shift. It's sort of like the analogy is going from the flat Earth theory to the round Earth theory, spherical Earth. Once you're at the spherical Earth theory, it's easy to look back and see why people believe the flat Earth. And the flat Earth theory worked really well. It still works, you know, when you're driving around, you don't probably take into account the curvature of the Earth. So it's easy to look back, but it's extremely difficult when you're in the prior theory to make sense of the steps you need to get to the later theory. So usually what happens is you get to the later theory and then you look back. So I want you to understand that that's kind of a dilemma that we're in here. I can't reason you from, you know, mechanics to engineering, but I can get you to engineering, and then I can get you to see then what the steps are and why it works. Okay, and also another way to say this is that the engineering worldview, I'm going to say, is more general. It's the bigger tent within which mechanical models work. Are special cases, just like the flat Earth theory is considered to be a special case within the idea that the world is spherical. So similarly, I'm going to do that with the other. Okay, so there are two, this is kind of the fugue thing. I'll tell you a couple of things here because I think they are helpful, but I'm not going to go in depth on them right now, but they'll come up later. What's particular to mechanics is that it has this outsider view, some call it the detached observer or the spectator perspective. What that means is if I'm really trying to understand objective reality, what I mean by objective reality is something that's completely independent of me, the observer, and of my observing, okay? So that's kind of the deal. But so that's the kind of outside objective thing. And the participant, however, is an inside view. And it pictures us as inside reality and what inquiry is and so forth needs to be understood within that context. Now, the argument here really simply about the shift is that the outside view is clearly an idealization. I mean, we are in reality, so the idea that we're studying objective reality that's where we're not there is there's something funny about that. Okay, or it's limiting. It's not that we don't do that, and it's nice to do that sometimes, but... that's not what it's about. Okay, so I just want to say the outside view is limited, and the participant, I'm going to say, is the more general understanding of the world, and the participant view, in the mechanical view, things tend to be static. I'll go into this more later. And the participant view, the universe is developing. Okay, So that's a kind of, I'm just going to lay that out there. The participant representation, the universe develops qualitatively, as I say, non-mechanically. And it emerges, it changes as it goes. And the emergence, the evolution, is the unfolding of an idea, and the idea is freedom. That's a kind of a sub-quote from Hegel, if you like. History is the unfolding of an idea, and the idea is freedom. Okay, another way to express the shift is in the spectator research program. That's like trying to understand everything mechanically in terms of mechanical theories. What you're trying to do is you're trying to understand how the world works, okay? You just say, like, if you're in the spectator idea as well, we find ourselves incarnate in the world and we have some food and we're shelter and we're getting a little bored. So we think, why don't we try and figure out how the world works, just for fun? Key phrase, just for fun. It's not particularly any benefit in doing it. We'd be able to predict things, but I guess maybe we would have predicted that we were going to predict them, or there's something funny there too. So it's not clear what they're doing. So how the world works in this detached way is one thing. If you put yourself inside the world, then you have a different problem. And your problem is essentially how to live and how to get along in the world, how to work in the world. So knowledge in the participant model is really something that's very practical, and one of the people in this tradition says that it's only meaningful knowledge if it's something that at least potentially is useful. Okay. So this is again a preamble sort of thing. Who are the engineers? So engineers believe that they have free will, which means they have the ability to change the course of events. And they believe they can change the design and operation of reality. They can build a dam, they can change the course of events, they can build buildings, this is their thing. And engineers see themselves as problem solvers. Okay, and what is problem solving? This is a kind of definitional. Problem solving is trying to move from a current state of affairs to a future more desirable state of affairs. Really simple definition, okay? So what is engineering? So the defining problem in engineering, if you go to engineering textbooks and go through it, if you go to science books, they say, what are we doing? We're discovering the truth. We're discovering the laws of the universe. We're discovering. Okay, well, the engineers, their discovery is nice. Thank you very much for that, for those little tools. But what they're really about is design. What's called the problem of design. And give an idea of this. So it's how should we design? We design tools to do all these things, but how should we design the irrigation of our fields? How should we design our houses? How should we design our neighborhoods? How should we design our cities? How should we design our economy? Should we have tariffs or not? How are we going to do? Kind of a design are we have for our economy? And then how are we going to design our political system to preserve our economy, however we want, and so forth? Okay. So these are all design questions. And one way to put this is to say, like, the easy way to get hold of this is, so the American Constitution is an experimental design document. Okay, it's not derived from anything. It's historically, a lot of people did it. They put it together, and it's a design. It's a design for the political system. Okay. So what's the physicist's attitude? I love this picture of Steven Weinberg, great guy. So Steven said this, this was in an article in Daedalus a number of years ago, but he also said this to me when he was here. He said, isn't it quaint that engineers think that they can change the course of events, since we physicists know that the course of events is uniquely determined by universal laws everywhere from the beginning of time. So you know, surprised, I asked Brian Greene about this, and he goes like, yeah. I go like, Brian. I told him he was stupid, but yeah, he laughed. He told me how much money he was making. I shouldn't say that. I should have told you that. But So I've said before, the engineering worldview, I want to say, is the more general worldview. And here's the interesting thing. You can experience the limits of a system of thought while you're still in the system of thought, but you can't understand the limit, okay? I was going to say that to you. You'll see how that marks down. So what I'm going to say is that where we're at now, where we've been since quantum theory came along, at least, and maybe, you know, on and off before that, we can see that we got a problem. Quantum theory and relativity don't really fit into the classical Newtonian model. Okay, so there's a problem here. How do they fit in? I mean, there's, we know what mechanics was, nice billiard ball, you know, Newtonian projectiles and orbiting things. And then electromagnetism came along and other things that don't really quite fit. So what I would say is we can experience the limit, but to understand the limit, we have to actually go outside mechanics, and that's what we're going to do. That's really one, when I get into it, that's the paradigm shift, and that's what I want to lead you through today. Okay, so boom. And what I'm going to do, I presented this a couple times, and I presented the technical stuff first, and that quantum theory and stuff like that, and then they did the so what later, and a couple of people said, you know, I really understood it once you gave me the so what. I didn't quite follow where you were going with the earlier stuff because it was very interesting, but it's like, what? So I've decided I've rewritten this for tonight. A little dangerous thing to do, but I did. And so what I'm going to do is start at the end of the talk that I've done before, and go forward, and then kind of middle to end, I'm going to go back and do the other earlier stuff. So here are my theses, basically. I'm going to say economic systems are engineering enterprises. Okay. And then I'm going to go on, I'm going to say biological evolution. The first one you can kind of, that's not too surprising, right? Then I'm going to say biological evolution is an engineering enterprise. That might surprise you a little bit. And then the more radical one is I'm going to say the whole cosmos is an engineering enterprise. And the value part that comes into this, the universe is always moves to the good, I'm going to argue to you. And as an engineering enterprise, the universe is about the construction of the good. That's a phrase from an earlier American pragmatist. Okay, so here we're going to roll. So I'm going to talk about economics as an engineering enterprise. So modern economics began as a moral science. You have a general consensus starts with Adam Smith, a book called The Theory of Moral Sentiments, and then the inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations, usually short called the Wealth of Nations. And he really got in and looked at the specifics of how the thing worked and stuff, and so that's a very famous thing. And the other guy was Thomas Malthus, and you've probably heard him, any of you know anything about Darwinian stuff, Malthus's principle of populations was extremely important, and he sort of said, you know, populations always expand faster than their resources. Which I'm going to show you is wrong. So the next thing that happened, though, and this is very important, so and there are a number of people, I just picked out Leon Walras, but there's probably a dozen that were doing around the same time the same thing, but he came up with something called equilibrium theory. So what he was a Viennese guy, or French, I guess, Walras, and what he did, he wanted to create economic science, okay, this moral stuff, you know, it's kind of like, who needs that? So he wanted to create a mathematical modeling of economic systems. Okay, and so what he did, he modeled it on Newtonian mechanics. And there were two things about it. And, you know, in Newtonian mechanics, you know, first law, nothing moves unless you hit it with something, you know, and then it keeps going until you. Okay, so you have this. So it says essentially that a system remains at rest unless acted on by something from outside. Okay, you can see that's very important to where we're going. And the second law is not so crucial. And then the third law says every action has an equilibrium reaction. Well, if you take that really seriously, what it says is nothing happens. Okay, So if you add it all up, nothing happens. Okay, there's like there's a equilibrium and a symmetry to the system, and that's very fundamental to Newton. And so Balras creates economics along those lines. So one of the things is once you go to the mathematical modeling of an economy, then you're into a descriptive mode. It's not clear you're prescriptive. If you're supposed to be able to predict things, then you go to the policy guy and say, well, I'm predicting this is going to happen. And he says, well, if that's going to happen, then why would we, you know, if it's really going to happen, then wait a minute, it's not really going to happen. It could happen unless you, you know. So it's not, if the models are not, have this sort of inside-outside problem again. Are we able to act in the world on the basis of these models, or are they predicting something, and are they predicting it, it's called ceteris paribus, all things being equal. So there's a problem with that. But the main thing is I want to get at is that once you go to mathematical models, you're not really talking policy anymore. I'm just saying this is the way it works, this is the way it happens. The policy guy's interested? Maybe, maybe not. Okay. But values disappeared. That's one of the main things. Okay. All we have is things that move around according to mathematical laws. Okay. So then something happened, and it starts really maybe early part of the 1800s. And so an economy always does this supply-demand equilibrium thing, okay? And it's always supposed to be there. And then occasionally the equilibrium point will jump up, and it'll go out of equilibrium and come back, and it'll go down a little bit. So sometimes it comes up, so maybe you had a hurricane hit your economy. Well, your economy, you know, does not perform so well, so the equilibrium point drops a little bit. If you get a plague, that's not too bad. Well, you had a war, you won the war. Well, that maybe goes up. Okay, so the equilibrium point goes up and down. And it's always said that the point is it's external, just like the Newtonian thing being hit from the outside. Okay, so the things that change the equilibrium point are always external, and they're called externalities sometimes, although that term's used more broadly now in economics. The term they use is exogenous. Okay, it's an exogenous influence. Okay, so it means something came from outside, changed the equilibrium thing. Okay, and then something happened, this equilibrium, we started seeing this. The equilibrium point started going up and up and up, particularly in industrialized nations. And so Schumpeter was the first guy to say, to look at it. He's a Viennese guy, turn of the century, and he said, it's the technology, stupid. These technological innovations are making the economy more productive, and we're able to do more things, and that's why the equilibrium point's going up. Okay. So, so the same sort of thing. So I would give you an example. So this guy, Robert Solow, in 1950 got the Nobel Prize in economics, or the early ones. And an example he gives is like in 1850, the farmers were producing about 2 bushels of corn per acre, okay, per farmer per acre, worker per acre. And by 1950, it was 200, okay, same amount of land. Okay, so that's an example of what was going on. And it was obviously better fertilizers, plowing, you know, all sorts of techniques that we used. So the equilibrium point is moving, and its technological innovation is all of a sudden, oh, it's the technology. And this is what Solow says. Yeah, hey, look, it's the technology that's actually pushing the equilibrium point up. But it's still exogenous. You know, like, oh, isn't it interesting that somebody invented something and it had some economic influence? But economies are about supply and demand. And then the models are there, okay? So they kept staying with the mechanical models. So then, in 1990, something, a miracle happened. And there's this guy, Paul Romer. Romer did a physics degree initially, and then he went to Chicago and did his economics PhD, suffered under Milton Friedman, and then he went off to Stanford, where he'd been for 20 years or so. He just moved to NYU, a big program there. But what Romer said is, he said, wait a minute, no, technology isn't an externality, isn't an exogenous factor in economy. Technology is what economies are about, okay? They're about producing things, about producing wealth and creating things and building things and doing, okay. So I like to do this hand thing. So here's what Romer did. Instead of equilibrium like this, he went like that. Okay, so what economies are doing is this. Economies are always trying to develop. Economies are naturally developmental. And the way that one of the dramatic ways they develop is new technologies, but just using their old technologies to create, to build more buildings, to change the course of a river, to build a bridge, to do better agricultural techniques. Okay, so what he did is he changed, instead of this, you know, this rational optimizer utility theory of economics, you know, we're all supposed to be selfish rational optimizers. He goes, no, that's not what's going on. Said, no, we're all engineers. We're all creating for ourselves and in partnerships and so forth. We're creating these we're value actualizers, is another way to put it. Okay, and another thing I want to say about these changes are qualitative. And when you make qualitative changes in a mechanical, mathematical model, you get in trouble because your parameters changed. I had a friend I roomed with in London who was working on Leontief's models, your input-output economic models. I said, just figure the input and figure the output. And he goes, like, that's great, except that what's meant by a car or what's meant by a farmer or what's meant by a road changes. So the categories change and it screws up your mathematical modeling. So there's been a resistance to trying to take into account these innovations in economic theory. That's starting to happen a lot, but it's a lot of people refer to Romer. Only a few of them get it right. And this guy, I put this book up, Knowledge and the Wealth of Nations, David Warsh, I think he gets it right. So if you want to follow up on Romer, you go to his website too. He's got a lot of cool stuff. And what I say is you can't make sense of these qualitative changes within a mechanics that says, you know, it's like this. Okay, that's why they couldn't make sense of the technology in the first place. One of the examples that they use real quick is Romer uses is given ideas like how much work did you have to put out to produce a certain amount of light, and light at one lumen is one candle, so a number of hours. So in 500,000 BC, you get a certain amount of light from open fire, 1,000 lumens, you had to work 58 hours. And then by 1750 BC, the oil lamp comes in, 41 hours, then the tallow candle, 5.4 hours. Look at these. Okay, so for the same amount, so here you got a person in a society working in order to produce lumens. He's getting better and he's getting more and more efficient, not efficient, but more effective, I guess, more productive at producing light. And it's up now, it goes on, like, in 1990 this stops. I mean, it's like, I don't know how many seconds you're working in order to produce lumens. This is pretty amazing. And so what Romer's saying and people are saying is that this has been a trend going on for a long time, and this is what economies have been doing. Okay. I'm going to give you two quick examples of Romer here. So he gives about innovation. One, he gives us Starbucks. So this is not rocket science. So Starbucks used to have, you know, still has, you know, what is it, tall, grande, venti, okay? So they used to have three different sizes of lids for the three different sizes of cups. Now, if you go there, you find one size lid for all three cups, because all they did is change the geometry of the cup, okay? That's an innovation. So it simplifies the supply chain for Starbucks. They have one less thing to do. It's cheaper, so forth. So that's an innovation, makes them more efficient. Now they can pass, you know, maybe give your coffee to you cheaper, or they can give the stockholders more money or something. But obviously, that's an innovation that makes them more productive. Okay. Now, and that's an idea. And one of the things that Romer talks about, this is an idea, and it's an idea that's not consumable. Like, there's only one cup of coffee. Either you drink it or I drink it. You know, boom, that's it. Competitive, if you like. But ideas are not like that. Particularly engineering ideas, how to do things. I look over the fence and see my neighbor plowing. I see that he gets a really pretty good yield. I go, plow, that's an idea. Well, maybe we'll do that, okay? So these are ideas, and these ideas, recipes they're sometimes called, are what are the stuff that engineers produce, okay? And this is like how to do this, how to do that. They're all method sort of things. So, so his other example is, he said 10 years ago, I had to pay $100 to get a gigabyte of RAM for my computer. Okay. He says, today I can get that same gigabyte of RAM for $10. And then he adds, and he said, and I didn't do anything. I'm gonna repeat that. So 10 years ago, he had to pay $100 for a gigabyte of RAM. Now he pays $10 for a gigabyte of RAM. And he goes like, and I didn't do anything. Now what's important, this is really, really important. What's important is that someone else in my society solved the problem or came up with something new, and it benefited me. So it's in my interest that you succeed. It's in my interest that you succeed. Does that sound Darwinian to you? No. Okay. Now, it doesn't mean I might want you to compete. We might compete. But that competition is so that I'm going to stimulate you, or you're going to stimulate me to create another. I'm going to kind of find something cool. You're going to come up with something neater. And that's great. You make some money on it. That's cool. But we're all doing cool stuff. We're all helping each other, and it's all going. Okay. Sometimes we'll cooperate. Sometimes we'll compete. But it's all within this different context, which is, it's in my interest that you succeed. So it's also like, it's look at the spread of risk, one of the policy implications, the spread of risk. It's very interesting, very important for us to fund research, fundamental research, because fundamental research is very high risk, okay? But the payoff is huge. But if I want one small company to take on that risk and pay for it, they're not going to do it after a while. This guy here, Skip Rung, tells the story of what happened to Hewlett-Packard. They couldn't sustain their research arm because the profit coming back from what they were putting out wasn't enough. But the stuff they turned out has just been hugely successful. The printers, the microchips, all sorts of stuff. For the overall economy, we all benefited enormously, but they couldn't take the risks, and not happen to Hewlett-Packard. So when I say that this is called, what Romer's on about, is called New Growth Economics. So I'm writing a paper called, with this title, New Growth Economics, New Growth Politics, New Growth Morality. And I think you can get the picture, okay? So the new politics is, if you like, for us working together, and the new morality, if you like, is not this Darwinian, selfish, and I'll stab you in the back, or we'll cooperate until I can stab you. No, the growth aspect is such that we're all working together, even when we're working apart, okay? Okay, so here's another thing. So normally functioning economies produce surplus, and you can see how this works. So that computer starts working through its way through the economy, okay, everybody starts doing something a little bit more efficient. This guy does it more efficient, then he can sell his product to me a little bit less. But then that means I can sell my product to someone else a little bit less, and that means they can sell it to somebody else. Okay, so there's an exponential process that goes on here. When you get a new technology that allows people to be more efficient, and it's an idea that can be passed around, it has an accelerating, exponential effect in the economy. So the growth just goes dynamite, okay? There's a Kurzweil, and these guys are on, they have a whole Accelerated Technologies Institute now. They're very interested in what's the next accelerating technology. And pretty much all of them are. So the one thing I say is that because of this, everybody getting more efficient and stuff, all of a sudden I have surplus. Okay, it cost me so much to produce my product, and all of a sudden they gave me a computer, and now I can do it for 70% of what I was costing me before. So I got, and for my resources, I got 30% of resources left. So economies naturally produce surplus. Okay, it's very non-Malthusian, if you like. Okay, so a normally functioning economy produces a surplus. And overall, here's the phrase I want you to get. An increasing capacity to perform work. Okay, so as we get more and more efficient, as we build more and more things, our ability to perform work, to do things in the world, whatever we want to do, from art to, go to the moon or whatever, increases. Okay. Okay, so as the economy increases, our ability to be in a better economy also increases. It's subtle. It's a learning knowledge. So when I learn something, that allows me to learn something more. Okay, that's the idea. So as economy develops, it also allows me to be a better economy. And in a better economy, that can be a better economy, all right, or society. I mentioned ideas can be shared, and that tends to make an accelerating effect. And Romer says, it's not how much land there is, not how much water there is, not how much gold there is. It's what you do with it. Okay? Now, Paul Ehrlich, who is of the other side of this thing, the mechanical thing, Paul Ehrlich is an economist out of Stanford. In 65, he predicted that we would all starve to death by 1985. And my friend Joel Gross said, this has got to be the most fundamentally refuted prediction in the 20th century. Not only are we not starving to death, but we have massive surpluses of food. And the population has grown up to 9 billion something now, or close to that. So Romer has been called the post-scarcity economist, and or post-Malthusian. So basically this idea that Malthus had that economies, groups, naturally will out-consume, will produce more people than product they will consume. Basically, Romer's saying for a good functioning economy, that's in fact the opposite is true, that the economy produces more too much. That's why economies overheat. It's because they're really pumping along. They get too much stuff. Everybody gets really happy. And we go, well, I'm getting richer and richer and richer. I think I'll let people get irresponsible about how they're doing. Okay, so, and it's this surplus that allows populations to grow. So we've gone from, I don't know, we're saying 150,000 people a couple million years ago or whatever, whenever we say we started, up to now we got 9 billion. The reason that's possible is because of this process, this developmental process that's expanding this, our capacity to perform work, expanding our resources, we're building our resource base. And just a note there at the bottom that the reason evolution is possible is because of the same thing, but that's, I'm getting ahead of myself. So just to know that I'm not crazy and Romer isn't crazy, there's a bunch of people out there. It's just book recommendations, The Rational Optimist, How Prosperity Evolves. He's making many of the same points and saying, oh yeah, everybody's worried about sustainability and the water's going bad and all this sort of stuff. And he goes back, he says, just look at the last 100 years, what we've done. It's just amazing. Everything's so much better than it was 100 years ago. Now, when we get better, we also screw up and we have unintended consequences and all this sort of stuff. But overall, we're doing awfully good. Very good. So another one, What Technology Wants, is a guy, Kevin Kelly, who created Wired Magazine. And I love this title, and it's a great book. Nobody reads it. and his subtitle is good. It's like, technology is a living force that can expand our individual potential if we listen to what it wants. Okay, similar theme, okay? So there's another book by this guy, Diamantis, who was involved in the prize for going up in outer space and stuff. And he wrote this book called Abundance, The World is Better Than You Think. He goes through the technologies as far as people worried about the water. He goes like, no, we got that. That's solved. Here's the technology. We know how to do that. We just need to deploy it. There can be plenty of fresh water. Here's how we do it. Here's how we power it. Worried about energy. We've got that solved. We got these little energy things that will circulate the water. You know, he goes through the whole thing. He's saying all these people are worrying about this and worrying about that. Not that you didn't worry about it, but the technology is already, you know, coming out the door that this is going to solve this problem. And the last one is this guy, one of my favorite people in the world, William McDonough. And he's the guy who got all the prizes for being Mr. Environmentalist and all this sort of stuff. And McDonough wrote a book a while back called Cradle to Cradle. And one of the things in the book, he says, you know, I'm tired of waking up every morning. This is sustainability. He said, I hear this stuff about sustainability. He says, it's like getting up every morning and asking how you can be less bad. Okay, so what he argues in that is that we should be designing, he wants to recycle everything, you know, everything's going to be, he wants to design the society so that there is no waste, so that what was waste ends up being product and so forth, okay? So that's an earlier one. And we design our society that way, our cities, everything to design to be able to go cradle to cradle. So if a car goes out, I mean, this is one of the things like BMW has a deal now. If you create this car and you sell it to somebody on the environment, ultimately you're responsible for recycling that car. Okay, it doesn't go into a dump. It goes back to BMW, and they do something. A lot of people are doing, you know, adopting that practice. And that was a McDonald thing. Okay, so just a brand new book out. I think it's just like out this week. And this my daughter turned me on to it. It's called The Upcycle. It says, Beyond Sustainability, Designing for Abundance. And it says it all. Okay. All right. Now we're going to shift. So evolution as an engineering enterprise. So there's this guy, George Bulliarello, who was actually in the lecture series a number of years ago. He's a chancellor of the Polytechnic University of New York, National Academy of Engineering. He's a major player. He used to be the editor of their mag and so forth for years. Probably on every, you know, all these committees of engineers that have to look at different things. You know, is this system any good? Is that system any good? Or National Planning of Engineering. George was on all these committees. So he's a major guy. And Basically, he wanted to say that engineering, I'm saying engineering economics, but engineering is a natural extension of biological evolution. Okay? So George would say, he said, every engineer should be taught that engineering is a natural extension of biological evolution. Why wouldn't anybody ever think that? So let's say, you know, I don't want to pick on diabetics here, but we invented insulin a while back, okay? And one of the things was type 1 diabetics, very rarely were they able to reproduce because they were cooked by the time they were 15, 16 years old, okay? They were, it's hard, not many of them lived past that. Now, they're living 50, 60, 70 years. They're having families, they're going on. So if they had a genetic flaw that this causes diabetes, type 1 diabetes, I'm going to say fly, disability, whatever, they're now spreading that all through the gene pool. Okay? So it looks like this technological innovation is actually weakening the gene pool. Okay, but this is I'm going to take this argument. So what about agricultural advances? How many people in the history of, say, the last couple thousand years, how many people would have died without agricultural advances? You know, the weaker people who couldn't get to the food or whatever, we didn't share it with them. And how about all sorts of medical advances, housing, clean water? There's an argument that 95% of all the advances in health and longevity in the industrialized world over the last 300 years are due to prevention, not curative. Okay, cleaning up the water, cleaning up the sewers, food that wasn't contaminated, refrigeration, I mean, on and on. All these things make it easier for weak people to survive. Okay, so it sort of looks like, I say, wait a minute, so what's going on here, George? I mean, there are people that wrote early on, they said, you know, as soon as Homo habilis, that's the toolmaker, as soon as Homo habilis came along, evolution stopped because we're fighting natural selection. All these natural selection forces, those are problems for engineers. They're going to solve it. You know. So what happens is all the weak people stay along with all the strong people. Okay? I was just talking about a flower. So like all the weak people are in the delicate parts in the center. And anyway, so that's kind of funny, isn't it? So and I told you this thing about the engineer narrative of the engineering, of all these engineering advances there. So what George wants to say and what I'm going to try and tell you is that actually that's a clue that there's something wrong with the thinking, okay? So what we're looking for is, what George wants is one consistent narrative. He wants a narrative that tells me about evolution and it tells me about engineering, and it's one consistent narrative. Right now we're going like, boom, something happens here when people come along and start fighting natural selection. Okay, so, and I'm going to pump on here. So the Dorian Sagan, it's Carl Sagan's son, and wrote a book called Into the Cool, which I'll show you a little bit more. So he and this guy Eric Snyder are taking an ecological view, but they're not evolution. They want to know, like, okay, 3.7 billion years ago, there's a couple of bugs around or something, whatever they were, and now we got this, okay? So the question is, what happened? What happened? Okay, what is there a story here? Okay, is it more what? Okay, so Steve Gould has a famous book called Wonderful Life. He's a leading evolution biologist, if you don't know him. And Gould said, well, if we got random mutation and then natural selection, and I don't even know what natural selection is selecting, because it's some days it selects for this and some days it selects for that. And so he said, let's just say we ran the tape of evolution back 27 years ago, started over, what reason do we have to believe that we would end up with anything like this? And Gould says, zip. Okay, we could have been snakes. I mean, even under this, we could be, our progeny could be, you know, mosquitoes, or, you know, there's no directionality to it at all. And if you Google evolution and look at the official evolution guides, they're all defaulting to change. You know, what is evolution? Change. Well, everybody who ever looked at evolution thought, evolution, that's a development, right? There may be something happening there. But the neo-Darwinians are going like, we don't know what to say is happening, except that it just happened and it's chance. So we're just saying evolution is change. Come on, guys. So there's a little problem there. So anyway, so Sagan and Snyder say, well, obviously there's more life, okay? I mean, go back, there were hot volcanoes and wasn't a very pleasant environment. There wasn't a lot of life. So there's more life, okay? So quantitatively, we know there's more life. That's happened. Okay, there have been some diebacks, but today anyway, maybe you'll die back soon, but right now it's generally a dieback. And there's more diversity. Okay, one of the funny things, I don't know if you guys ever had this experience when you're learning Darwinian theory, you say, yes, everything's competing with everything else, and obviously, you know, we're the winners. So what are all these other species doing around? I mean, we won. Why are they still alive? You ever had that feeling? It's a little funny. So if it's all massive, everybody's competing with everybody else, there's something funny going on there. But no, in fact, there's this qualitative diversity of life. There are many, many ways to make a living. Okay, but they want to say something more. And it's this more that I want to get to, if the computer will work. And what they do, in order to say what the more is, they take an engineering model. And this is standard engineering stuff. The engineering thing is, in order to have an engine do anything, you need to have an energy gradient. So like you have a hot source, and then you have a cold sink. You guys hear a lot about this because of this climate change and CO2 and everything. So the sun is the hot source, and space is the cold sink, and the climate problem is the CO2 changes the frequency of light going out, so maybe we're going to heat up a little bit, we'll see. But the main thing is what they say is that, look, the biosphere is an engine in the middle of this, okay? So it's using this gradient, this energy gradient, to be able to drive engine Earth, engine biosphere Earth, okay? The other thing they look at that the Darwinians look at, this goes to this niche and this goes to this niche. What the ecologists do, and these guys, they look at the organization of the whole system. These aren't just different ways of making a living. They're all related. Okay, and they're related not just, you know, my cousin or something. They're related economically. And they're related engineering. So there's a structure to the biosphere, okay? Dorian's mother was Lynn Margulis, who came out with Lovelock and the Gaia theory, so that's part of it. So they're looking at the organization. So what they want to say is that the biosphere has got better and better at, this is Dorian's term, degrading the gradient. So there's gradients there. So obviously if you use up this hot-cold gradient, eventually it goes to, you know, everything's the same temperature. It's the idea, basically. Okay. So, but it's getting better and better at doing it. Well, obviously it's better because it has more life, but why is it better otherwise? They want to say there's something more going on. And they want to say it's more efficient. Dorian has a thing, he was actually here, maybe some of you saw this, takes a liter bottle, Coke bottle, fill it with water, and he holds it up and it goes glug, glug, glug. And he says, watch this, fills it up again, he swirls it. Have you ever done this? Just comes out really fast. Now, what he's pointing at here is the organization of something and its efficiency. And I want you to think of this. The analogy here is the biosphere is kind of like the steam engine. You know, the early steam engine was really clunky, and they didn't have, you know, the compressing the water vapor and so forth. They didn't know how to do that very well. So, you know, Watt and Coulomb, I can't remember all the names of the guys, but there were several people. The evolution of the steam engine. And they must say the biosphere is like that. The biosphere is an engine, and that engine has developed. It's got more efficient. And how's it got better? It's got better technology. Okay, and so there's this evolving reorganization. New life forms come on, they reorganize, and the whole thing. So this whole thing's reorganized. Where's it going? It's going to be able to produce more work. It's being able to degrade that gradient. So let's say new technology is tools and rules. So it's new forms of life come up, and then the rules are the organizational stuff. So it's both tools and rules. I like that phrase. So two of the examples that they give, the oxygen, when I figured out how to release oxygen, then how to use oxygen. That was some opportunity to release the oxygen. Somebody had to figure out how to do that. So all these innovations were going on all the time, okay? Photosynthesis. There are four or five different kinds of photosynthesis, apparently, that started out, one with iron and one with, you know, molybdenum and so forth. And for the first 70%, Dupre, last speaker, said, no, he says, I say 80%. The history of life, for that first 80% of the history of life, is all one-cell stuff. And we now know that all these one-cell bugs, bacteria and archaea and so forth, they were exchanging ideas. They were exchanging genes all the time. That's what's going on. They would invent something, and it would get shared all the way through the biosphere. So the big ocean, they would just keep sharing stuff, and that's how the thing took off. And they said, well, if I can do that, then I could go over there, and I could do something more. And they go, okay, so the whole thing is a technological, you know, series of technological innovations that are shared. The system, like the economic model, by analogy, it gets more efficient, it gets more powerful, and it's able to perform more work, okay? Which work is to do things. All right. So the parameter of evolution. So the Darwinians are saying, well, I don't know, so I guess it's just chance. So they're saying, well, at least one measure of the evolution of life is an increased capacity to perform work. And work is what you're doing. Okay. And that's the same thing, that same phrase in the economic model. Okay, that's what Romer was doing too. So, okay. So when you have increasing capacity for work, you got surplus, you can explore more environments, you can problem solve, you can make the universe better. I'm real quick here. So this is a guy, a colleague of mine up at University of Victoria, Robert Reed, is this book. I think the book says it all, the title of the book, Biological Emergences, Evolution by Natural Experiment. So this variation that we see is not, you know, like, here are the laws of biochemistry, and then they make mistakes. I mean, come on. Mutations are much, much more complicated. Now we've got down in the genome, we understand there's a lot more complicated stuff going on. And what James Shapiro said a few lectures back was, in fact, the genome's actually pretty good at its own genetic engineering. Okay, and it's kind of what Reed is saying too. He's saying what that variation is, that those are experiments. They're kind of out there looking for relationships. They're looking for new environments. And so I talked to Bob about this, and his term is that the direction of evolution is what he calls increasing adaptability. I don't really like that word because I don't like adaptation as a concept, but adaptability. And what he means by that is we get greater and greater ability to explore new environments, to thrive in them and do new things. Okay, so that's what's going on. So the history of life is this experimental, exploratory process, and what it's going towards is increasing ability to do things. And I asked him, I said, is this the same thing? Do you think this is the same as what Romer's saying? He said, absolutely. All right. Increasing benefit of work. So I have to say something here about the concept of work. It's bothered me for a long time, figured it out. So there's a mechanical concept of work, and there's an engineering concept of work, okay, and they're different. The mechanical concept of work is just like you can raise one-pound brick 1 foot in a gravitational field or something like that. But in order to raise that, you have to have some sort of energy to raise it, and you have potential energy, and it goes back and forth, and okay, so that's work for the physicists and mechanics, okay? But work in the engineering context is different. Work is doing things. Stu Kaufman, who's written in this area a lot, talks about happenings and doings. Happenings are just stuff going around. Doings are some sort of coherent action. Okay, so work for the in an engineering context is some sort of coherent action. It could be running an experiment, searching for new ideas. It could be all sorts of stuff, but it's some sort of coherent action, okay? And it's asymmetric, so I'm just going forward here. Okay, real quick here. So this is a transition that I'm going to throw in. I thought I'll throw it in if I have time, which I don't really have. So I'm going to do it really quick. So what engineers believe, they believe they can change the course of events. I've said a lot of this before. They can alter the structure of reality, the design of operation, how things work. And they're all problem solvers or value actualizers. Problem of design, I've kind of got over this. So, and all those things, how to design all those things, there's a unity to that. This unity, for those of you who are into worldviews, very, very important of what holds it together, okay? And what holds it together is the problem of design. That all these different parts of the biosphere, all these different parts of the economy and everything, they're all, in some word sense, working together, and they all benefit each other, okay? We'll get more on that later. Okay, so you don't need that. Okay, so real quick, I talked about the spectator and the participant. This is something that John Dewey came up with I liked a lot. Not sure I like it quite so well anymore, but basically the spectator research program, just for fun, we're trying to figure out how the world works. This is a discovery project. And the things were converging to a fixed, if the nature of the universe doesn't stay the same, then I can't kind of get closer and closer and closer. Okay, it's a convergence model, okay? And one of the baggage that goes along with that is that nature of the universe has to stay the same, or this model isn't going to work, okay? So it means that the laws governing the nature, I'm presupposing that those laws are time invariant and space invariant. So Galileo drops the balls in Pisa in 16, whatever it is, and I can do the same experiment here in Portland in 2013, same experiment. Time variant, space variant. Okay, yeah. But it has to remain the same. If it doesn't remain the same, so if my action as an inquirer changes reality, okay, causally, then we got a problem because it's where did the target go? Where am I converging? I mean, it goes, it's not there anymore. So it's very clear that the idea that the laws of the universe at the time of the Big Bang and so forth, in the time 100 billion years from now or whatever, that those laws are things, that's not something to be discovered. That's an assumption. That's a presupposition of this mechanical model, which presupposes that there's a fixed reality. Okay. And this is one universal order, repeatability. You can reason all the start with repeatability. You can reason all the stuff. Same cause, same effect. Deterministic, it's a unique sequence. From any particular point in time, the next thing's going to happen, so forth. And this was the clockwork universe. So the mechanical hypothesis, I used to call this a scientific hypothesis, but the mechanical hypothesis, all phenomena are governed by one universal, which means time, space, invariant, causal order. Symmetry and conservation are models of this. Okay. Now the participant is, in fact, he goes like, oh yeah, of course I'm changing reality. You know, I'm going out there, I'm bumping into stuff all the time, dude, and I'm changing the structure of reality. And so inquiry alters the course of events, the nature of reality develops, which means then that there's an irreducible historical component to reality. Now this may seem commonsensical, but in mechanics there is no real history, okay, because it all just stays the same. But in the participant thing, there is at least, there's some sort of historical thing, okay, going on. And the inquiry, I'm going to say, inquiry is not convergent, it's emergent. So when I learn something, this is an experience that scientists have a lot, or researchers have. So you're working on a problem, and you're going, I finally figured that out. And you do have some sense of local convergence on that problem, but the experience is, ooh, that opens up a whole bunch of new questions I can ask. That gives me new things I can do. Now we got that, we can do this, okay? So that's the idea that questioning itself is emergent, okay? So our understanding is going like this. So we're not converging, we're not getting closer to some final theory of everything. In fact, we're getting more and more and more interesting questions. Okay, more technologies, more questions, okay. Okay, so another thing, the spectator's problem is discovery. His answers are gonna be objective facts. The test is predictions. In the participant's model, the program is emerging. He wants to know how to work better in the world. Solutions are methods. How do I do this? How do I do that? Build a super collider, whatever. And the test is demonstration. I'm going to go into this. There's a subtle difference between prediction and demonstration. Okay. Demonstrate, you show me, show me. Don't just tell me, I saw this thing out there and predicted it. You can predict anything. I'm not going to go through that again. I got to move on here. Okay, I already did that. Okay, so so we've gone through the two, the economics and the evolution. Now I want to go into how you get from mechanics to the engineering view. And we've been working on this for 100 years. And we pretty much haven't gone anywhere. This is I'm going to go into this with you a little bit, okay? So the key is complementarity, because the mechanical worldview says everything's operating according to one system, one complete and consistent system. Okay, that's standard. I could argue that for you in more detail, but that's basically it. It's one order, time, space, invariant, that's governing things. That's mechanics. So if all of a sudden it came along and somebody said, no, wait a minute, there are two orders, that'd kind of be a problem, wouldn't it? And I started out the larger thing here. There's the physics path, and there's a philosophy of science path. I'm not going to do the philosophy of science path. It has to do with falsification and Karl Popper. And basically, he said any theory that's meaningful has to be falsifiable, which is to say you need to tell me how you can falsify it. So you're going to run an experiment. Say, I'm going to run this experiment. I'm predicting that. Well, you tell me how you can do your experiment. I'll tell you how to smash your. I'll just smash your equipment. It won't happen. Okay, so it's always falsifiable. So here's what happened. So the refutation or the demonstration of the limit of mechanics didn't happen from just counter evidence. Because what happens, you have a scientific theory, you get some counter evidence, you get another scientific theory. Kind of helps on that one. And you get that, another one, scientific theory. And that helps on that one. You get this more criticism. So that, what's the limit to this? So Popper asked this question, you know, what evidence, if it were to occur, would lead you to give up the idea that the mechanical hypothesis, the mechanical research program was completable? Okay. And what happened is science and the mechanical thing didn't fail because it failed, because it still fails and it gets better and it fails and it gets better, and it fails and it gets better. It failed kind of because it had too much success. And the failure was that we had, you probably all, I got, I mean, history of science was, you know, modern science, Copernicus, Galileo, that goes up into Newton and all this sort of stuff. This is all great. This is all about, you know, billiard ball physics going around, stuff like that. Well, there's another history of physics, or history of science. And it has to do with people like Coulomb and Watt and Volta and Faraday and Maxwell. Kind of culminates with James Clerk Maxwell. So this is electromagnetism, okay? So these two different, very, very successful research programs, okay? Hugely successful. They do all sorts of stuff. Look at your cell phone. But these are, turns out, these are incompatible histories of physics. When you try to put these histories together, they don't come together too easy. And what we find is that what was discovered gradually by a lot of these guys here was that the particle program, how things move around, the particles, the Newtonian program was one talking about one kind of phenomena, and electromagnetism was talking about another kind of phenomena, and there didn't seem to be any common base. There's nothing that they could both be, oh, there's something beneath them that explains both of them. Okay, that wasn't there. And so the quantum situation is that we have different kinds of phenomena, and there are actually different kinds of laws, different mathematics and everything, okay, different space-time frameworks, sort of thing. So these guys are not coming together. So all of a sudden we got two orders that are not compatible. And what we want, in a sense, is we want a more general theory within which these two can be special cases. Okay? All right. So just, I'm going to go quick here. So the particle wave phenomena are complementary, stuff about conjugate variables and contraries and stuff that I won't go into. And so it was Niels Bohr who kind of came up with the idea of complementarity. And I'm going to show you his, this is his coat of arms. Am I saying anything? So this is the leading physicist, Nobel Prize winning physicist. What the heck is this? Okay. So he took this idea of complementarity very seriously. A lot of you might have read Fritjof Capra's book, The Tao of Physics. It kind of grabs the same idea and goes. Now, the other thing, this is his coat of arms. Because he's so famous and did wonderful things, he was inducted into the Order of Elephants or something like that in Denmark. And he had to choose a coat of arms. So this is his coat of arms. And this says, contraries are complementary. Now, idea of contraries is like rest and motion, change and constancy and so forth, constancy and development, so forth. Okay, so these are around a lot. So I'm going to read you these two. This is called appeal to authority. So I didn't really have to explain this stuff, and I'm running along, so I'm just going to read you these things. So Einstein's asked, what is reality? And he says, well, physics is an attempt conceptually to grasp reality as is thought independently of its being observed. And it's in this sense that we speak of physical reality. This is the classical model. So this Einstein's still talking this way. And then he says, in pre-quantum physics, there was no doubt as to how this was to be understood. In Newton's theory, reality was determined by a material point in space and time. As I remember, Einstein says, everything in Newton's theory assumes that everything's happening at the same time. It's called absolute simultaneity. And he says, well, the only way everything can happen at the same time is if everything's in the same place. So that's the material point, okay? So Newtonian reality is a sort of point. In Maxwell's theory, reality is a field in space and time. Okay, so Maxwell's idea of fields is they're completely spread out. And they're not just spread out in, this is tricky, they're not just spread out in space, they're spread out in time. Yeah, if that doesn't confuse you, you haven't been listening. So and then he says, in quantum mechanics, it's not so easily seen what the theory is, okay? So, all right, so the second one. So one thing that happened is this guy, Louis de Broglie, came along and he said, he figured out that actually any situation, every situation has both. It has both a wave aspect and a particle aspect, okay? Big deal. Okay, so that's a big deal. And I have an analogy of a soccer game. So when you go to a soccer game, and you look at a soccer game, is this are you observing competition or cooperation? All right. So that's sort of what De Broglie is saying about waves and particles. For every situation you look at, it's got both things there. You can focus on one, you can focus on another. You want to solve a problem about competition, you go one way. You want to solve a problem about competition. Okay? So that's basic idea. So Wolfgang Pauli, another Nobel Prize winning guy, says, in the new pattern of thought, we do not assume any longer the detached observer. It's the spectator. occurring in the idealizations of this classical type of theory. But an observer who is indeterminable, who by his indeterminable effects creates a new situation, theoretically described by a new state of the observed system. So every time you observe a system, you create a new system, you create a new system. And it's cumulative. You know, all your choices are included. So you choose that created one, and you choose it. Okay. So the choice is discontinuous, which I will go into a little bit. So here's the next one. So this guy, Anton Zeilinger, who I think is going to be here later in this month, too. Wrote a great book called The Dance of the Photons. Probably one of the half dozen top experimenters in the world right now. So I've got a nice picture of him there. And he says, the point is that the measurement of the inquirer, of measurement instruments, don't just influence or change the observed situation. He says, that would still be acceptable to classical thinking. So this idea you might have heard about, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, it's like, oh, we're disturbing things, you know, so we bumped into it. That's wrong, okay? So he said that would be acceptable if that's what's going on. But he said, that's not going on. What we've learned is that the choice of measurement instruments actually defines the property of the quantum system that becomes realized as an experimental result. So the choice of how to set up your experimental apparatus influences what you're going to see. If you look at the world one way, you see particle type stuff. If you look at it another way, you see wave type stuff. Okay, so Zeilinger again says, complementarity was introduced by Niels Bohr as one of the great lessons we learned from quantum physics. Bohr actually says the greatest discovery of 20th century physics. We always have to make choices. Okay, so if you got these two orders of reality and you're this in reality, you have to, if you look this way, you can see one thing, if you look that way, you see another thing. And okay, so... So a specific philosophical view has been definitely ruled out by experiment. This is the concept of local realism, the point of view that whatever we observe is defined in some way by a real physical property, that's Einstein's physical reality, property of the observed system, a property that exists before and independent of our observation, subjective reality. That's over. Okay, so if that's over, so Lee Smolin has this thing. I think it was in his book, The Trouble of Physics. But if you go online to his some of his seminars, you can see him at the Perimeter Institute in Toronto. And Smolin says, I entered physics in the 1960s as one of the second generation of quantum physicists. We were intent on solving the question, what is reality? We're the first generation of field. I talked to Freeman Dyson about Bohr and Heisenberg and Einstein. I said, where did they end up? And he said, they gave up. They just gave up. They couldn't figure it out. So Smolin says, it's now 2010. This is when he said it. It's now 2010, and it's become rather Kafka-esque. Those of you who don't know, Kafka is this guy who wakes up as a cockroach and stuff. It's a kind of weird Twilight Zone, if you like. So rather Kafka-esque that we haven't made any progress whatsoever. Okay, so here I'm going to have to press on here. So Heisenberger has this insight, and that not only are the observables complementary, but the ways of observing are complementary, okay? So that's his big, that's where his uncertainty principle comes from and so forth. And since these are two different, you know, they're not, one can't be reduced to the other, they're qualitatively different. So when I'm making a choice to observe this way or that way, it's a qualitative choice. And by its very nature, cannot have a mechanical explanation. Okay, so from the mechanical point of view, it's just, there is no explanation. So they commonly say, well, it's arbitrary. However you choose is arbitrary. It's an absolutely arbitrary thing. It's chance. Okay, it's just chance governed. Okay, but what's chance governed from a mechanical point of view is not necessarily chance governed from the engineering point of view. I'm going to buzz on here a little bit. Okay. So I kind of said this. So choices in the quantum theory are cumulative. the future mechanically is underdetermined. Okay, it just, you get this thing called Schrodinger's equation, and it doesn't say what's going to happen. It just says there are all these possibilities that could happen, and depends on how you choose, how you interact with it as to what will actualize. So this whole deterministic idea is gone, and what's replaced it is this idea of choice. And the choice is kind of free. I mean, it's like kind of funny freedom, it's just chance, but it is. It's irreversible, it's cumulative. I'm going to go into this. This is da-da-da-da. This is what I've been saying. So the participant formula. So what is this? What is the nature of choice? So in the mechanical thing, it's just arbitrary. In the participant formulation, all futures are undetermined, but when I make a choice, I'm actually choosing a particular future. Okay, that's just, and the choice is problematic. Okay, the choice is problematic. Well, what do engineers do? Problem solvers. That's kind of the move I want to make here, okay? So what it's saying is that the existentialists had a great little thing of this. So he said, they had an expression called, their little motto was, existence precedes essence. Now the opposite way around, essence precedes existence, would be my genes and my birth and my upbringing determine my life, okay? That's essence precedes, okay? What they're saying is, no, you're actually incarnate in the world, you're born in the world, and it's the choices that you make that will write the story of your life, okay? And that's this, but well, how do you make a choice? Well, the existentialists, they go like, I don't know, what am I going to do? They angst, you know, all this sort of stuff. Who am I? Who's the I? You know, I get kind of excited about it. I go like, whoa, I don't know what's going on at all. That's kind of cool. We could do anything, you know, or listen to somebody about it. So they have the ability to act, but no script. And that's the same with the engineer. But the engineer, where the translation to the engineering side is it's experimental. So everything that I do is in some sense experimental and exploratory. Okay, everything you do, every day of your life, you're doing something experimental, exploratory. You think, oh, I do that, it happens every time. Well, might not be happening the next time. So anything you do is experimental, exploratory, because the universe is developing. So that uncertainty that, you know, looks very weird in quantum theory and, you know, angst and whatever. And for the engineer, it's like, hey, no, this is my ability to act in the world. This is freedom. And so learning is a natural component of the universe. I see choice is a natural component. The engineering framework wants to say that choice is actually learning. Okay, learning doesn't happen in mechanics. It's just like, it's not there. It's the same thing. Okay, and basically, Kuhn and Feyerabend and these guys, basically, Kuhn's book, Structure, Scientific Revolution, said that learning is discontinuous, is logically discontinuous. This group called the Logical Positivists said, well, you know, scientific method is this very systematic thing, you know, and I'm afraid it's being taught a lot still in the schools. It's just the students need to know is how to crunch data, you know, get the data and then they'll crunch it and make, you know, graphs and stuff like that. What Feyerabend and Lakatos and these guys were saying was, no, like real learning, real advances are not like that. Okay, you can't calculate the advance. It's not a systematic thing. Kuhn's book was called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. The revolution was that to move from one state of learning to another state of learning. If you really learn something, it has to be qualitatively different from what you knew before. If you already knew it, you just, you know, run the logic machine and so forth. And this has changed in kind of funny ways. Like Hawking has in Brief History of Time, he has this thing where he has to turn science over to computers. He told me later, he says, it's very embarrassing that he ever said that. And a lot of the interest in what's called artificial intelligence comes from this same notion that, well, wait a minute, the world must be mechanical, so whatever intelligence must be mechanical, so we should be able to create mechanical intelligence. That hasn't worked. Okay, so Dewey has a thing, an advance in science is an advance in method. This is the same thing. When I learn something, I learn how to learn better. It's a recursive self-feeding system. Okay, so what I've said here in this complementarity thing is that the evidence for the limit of the scientific mechanical thing came up as complementarity. It came up that there were multiple orders in the universe and there wasn't a way to resolve them into no common denominator, no common stuff. De Boer has a quote that I have to go find. His friends are all trying to figure out what is the quantum world, what is it made up of, and he says there is no quantum world. Get over it. That's pretty, you got to think that through for a while, because basically it's an undecidable question. That's what he's saying. He's like trying to figure out what it's made of. He says, that's not a decidable question, so it's not a meaningful question. Okay. Okay, so complementarity entails choice. Choice for the spectator is this passive, you know, what should I believe? And how should I observe? And these are things that in the philosophical side, really, and they just, the answer is undecidable. The participant's choice is how to act. How should we live? How should we live? That's the fundamental unifying question that defines the problem of design, too, okay? For those of you who had philosophy, you'll notice that that's, Socrates said that was the most important question. Okay, just a real quick thing on Dewey. He said this stuff about knowledge. Knowledge is embodied. Okay, there's a lot of people talking about complexity theory now. I took Complexity magazine for like 6 years and I just threw it away because they never come up with a definition of complexity. This is a guy out of Santa Fe. I used to call him gutless wonders. Gutless wonders, because really what they wanted to talk about in complexity, you know, evolution is this growing complexity. What is it, complexity? I mean, is a glass more complex than I smash it on the ground? Which one's more complex? I mean, it depends on what you want to look at it. Is, you know, they didn't have any definition at all. What they're really looking at, though, and what they're pointing at is this increasing, developing organizational design of the biosphere, okay? And you're not going to get there mechanically. They're not going to happen, okay? So, but all the knowledge that we're gaining is actually embodied. Okay, look at this building. This is embodied knowledge, okay? Or knowledge built out of the knowledge and some creativity. Okay, so... So Dewey's final thing is to say, okay, here's a, I'm going to give you this. So Dewey has, so if problem solving is trying to move from a current state of affairs to a future more desirable state of affairs, now we're going to make mistakes. But we can figure, I mean, one thing is sustainability as a rule of thumb. It's like, don't run any experiment that if it fails, you're going to die, you know, or you're going to blow up the world or something. So when you're doing experiments, and when Robert Reed's organisms are doing an experiment, evolution by natural experiment, the experiments are doing, they're not checking, they're not saying, hey, let's, you know, pull out the bottom rung of reproduction or something. No, they're looking at a certain range of experimental options that they're exploring, okay? And that's, and we're doing that too. So what Dewey's saying, so get off here. So problem solving is moving from a current state of affairs to a more desirable state of affairs, and we do it fairly well. So we're trying to make the world better. We do make the world better, and I think there's evidence for that. That's why I gave you the two examples, the economics and stuff. There's evidence that we do better, okay? And we have parameters of how to do that. So, but what is, so the whole system, if everything's involved in this choice thing, then the whole universe actually has to make these choices. The whole universe is a problem-solving enterprise. Okay, and so the whole universe for Dewey is what he calls the construction of the good. Okay, the good is just the better, if you like, okay? All right. It's not predetermined. Immanuel Kant said something similar. You say, what is the good? And he says, well, it can't be conceived. And I'll explain that to you in a minute if I get over here. Okay, so here's what I've said. Political economics is an engineering enterprise. Biological evolution is an engineering enterprise. Inquiry and knowledge are part of those things. We search for knowledge, and the knowledge is we learn by doing. It's one of the good participant phrases, learning by doing. One of the greatest benefits of going to the moon was not going to the moon. It was all the technology that we developed, all the things we had to explore, all the things we had to do that got used in different ways in different places, all these ideas that were shared in many, many different technologies. So in the end, I want to say the whole universe is a engineering enterprise. And you have to, there's a thing about the thermodynamics which I haven't gone into. And I say it this way: if you drink the Kool-Aid of the thermodynamics of biological evolution and economics, you have to go the whole way. You have to say no. The whole universe, the structure that we've seen in economics, the structure we've seen in biology, the formation of the solar system has to come under the same. Gabor Bossri was here. He and I talk about this all the time about the problems of explaining how the universe was formed. The solar system. The solar system is a big gradient system. Hot, sun, cold. How did that form? Was this gravity? Maybe not. We don't even know what gravity is anymore. And the universe itself, the whole Big Bang. What the heck's that? I mean, okay. All right. So I'm going to stop there, if you can believe. I'm only 10 minutes over. And let's do some questions. So I'm sure this was all entirely, totally clear. But it's a big change. It's a big change. It's not new. I could trace it back to various things. But the static universe versus developing universe, we're outside the universe, we're inside the universe. And on the unlikely situation, nobody has any questions, I can go on.